started, my name is Michelle Rotbart. I am the culture director at Fashion Snoops, and I'm so excited to be here for a couple reasons. First off, because I always like to come to any trade show involving leather because you guys have the best food and the best drinks. We have to go to a lot of these trade shows, and this is always one of the most exciting. Second of all, because actually both my alma maters are here. I'm a graduate of the University of Cincinnati with a degree in design from DAC, and I'm also a graduate of Parsons from Strategic Design Management just recently. And I'm here representing Fashion Snoops, and today we're going to talk about leather serving today's values. If you're not familiar with Fashion Snoops, I'll just tell you a little bit about us. We are a global trend forecasting agency helping leading brands unlock innovation and propel growth. And what I think really differentiates us is we combine both the human and artificial intelligence to find trend-driven business opportunities and equip our clients with a blueprint of innovation. It's really important to start with the consumer, and it also requires kind of both sides of the brain, both our right part of the brain and our left side of the brain, as well as our heart. And it really requires a sense to gauge the shifts that are happening in the world, the data to support them, and the commercial skills to identify them. So with that, let's get started on how we see leather serving today's values from a cultural perspective. So what are today's shared values? You can see some of them behind me, everything from mastery of craft to slow living, to comfort, to personalization, to storytelling and sustainability. And what's really important to keep in mind is to succeed in today's environment, you really have to rethink of what value means to your audience. Today, people want more meaningful, individualized goods that are embedded with the values that resonate with them. So we know today that the consumer is a belief-based buyer and wants to associate with brands that cater to what they believe in. What's happening is that people no longer believe in big government and big institutions, so they really want to resonate with their brands and see themselves as part of what their brands are doing to kind of elevate their experience, to participate in personal identity, and to really find their desire. And so how does leather really play into this? Well, actually a very, very big role. So we like to think that leather is really today's paintbrush for what people want, and we're going to examine how we see that going forward. Okay, so the first one, mastery of craft. So our growing appreciation for handmade things delivers this big revitalization of the handicraft products. We live in a very digitized world, and more we want to reconnect with things that are tactile, things we can touch, things we can smell, things we can interact with. And products that are highlighting the making of this item, whether through weaving or hand stitching, or through smell or what be it, will really spark consumer interest. So here's an example of some of the best-in-class brands that we think are really doing this. So recently we're highlighting the Lueve baskets. Lueve is a Spanish luxury brand exploring the tradition of the basketry, and most recently at Milan Design Week. They used a signature naturally dyed leather, and it really elevated the woven containers and baskets that were made with strips of leather and bamboo. In the center, we have Dion Lee, and designed by them. Dion Lee is an Australian-based brand, and they developed a collection compromising a lounge chair and a bench made by slashed weaving and of leather. And this collaboration really aimed to unite the designer's experimental approach with the clothing company, also with designed by them, for a very minimalist aesthetic, and it really created a dynamic, robust, and comfortable piece of furniture. And the last one, which is very, very exciting here, is the 2020 Bentley Flying Spur. So most recently, Bentley actually announced that the Flying Spur will use a new type of leather upholstery with a three-dimensional diamond effect without traditional stitching. So really combining that whole idea of 3D technology and almost digital, things that look digitized and things that are very handcrafted. Following that is slow living. So slow living is something the consumer wants more and more. We all need to slow down. We all need to kind of de-digitize and unplug. We're shifting away from this whole idea of things that are new to things that are necessary and functional. We're extending the product life cycle through the chain of consumption, which is both impacting design and development. retail strategies and post-purchase decision-making. And these are all things we talked about this morning, but it is important to consider through a consumer's view. The other important thing to think about is how government legislation is actually impacting this as well and has having a role. So it's really forcing those who have not played the sustainability game and really encouraging the shift in consumer attitude for what we truly need. So people that are doing this successfully. So the first one I really, really love, personal anecdote. I have a pair of leather ballerina flats by a French company, and I have had them for years and years and years, and my significant other keeps trying to throw them away. I keep saying, like, no, they're perfectly worn in, they're perfectly aged, I can't live without them. So what I love, what Red Wing Shoes is doing, they're a Minneapolis-based company, and they make boots for heavy construction, but they recently opened a pop-up, or a full-line store, actually, in Midtown Manhattan, and you can visit the store for repair services. You can also send it in, but you can speak with any type of sales associate, really learn about the history of your product, get the professional appropriate footwear for yourself, and certainly engage with the brand and create a better relationship. The second one, we'd like to talk about slow travel as well. So the example here is the Rovos Train Tour, and that is an opportunity to discover Africa. It's all about a slow pace for railroad travel, and it's completely done, each car is completely done in leather, so it is absolutely the most comfortable. It goes all the way from South Africa to Cape Town over 2 days, and it's a really comfortable ride. And then the last one is an Italian leather goods company, and if I butcher this, I apologize, but it's Il Bolsont. And they highlight, they also opened up their first U.S. standalone store in the United States. And they really talk about the beauty and the aging process of leather. They really embraced positive aging. They offer paid refreshing services for weather-beaten bags. So if you have, you know, an old bag that you don't want to get rid of and your significant other keeps wanting to throw it away, you don't want to, you can bring it to them and they'll revive it for you. Coming up next is comfort. So at first I was like, how am I going to connect comfort and leather besides like wearing in old mean shoes? So there's this focus on wellness. It's combining a shift of working from home. Actually, by, I want to say 2020 later next year or in the next couple of years, we know that 75% of millennials and other generations are actually going to be working remotely from home and from home. So it's all about finding a balance between comfort and aesthetics and all about focusing on both relaxation, rejuvenation, and self-care. So how does leather play into this? Well, in a couple of different examples. So there's the Shinola Hotel. The Shinola Hotel, Shinola, as you know, is the American luxury goods brand based out of Detroit. They produce both watches, bicycles, and all sorts of fantastic leather goods. And they recently entered the hospitality market with a hotel that is completely furnished with their fine leather goods. The second, Estera Crystal Healing Footwear. So from a cultural space, we actually are always talking about alternative methods of healing. And this was a really interesting example because it combined both footwear and leather and crystals for healing. All of the crystals that are on these shoes are actually Reiki charged and are supposed to help not only sustain you, but sustain the life of the shoe. So it's supposed to, you know, not only incorporate ancient healing techniques with style, but it's very next level glowy. So if you want to combine crystals and footwear, this is your opportunity. And the next one here is another brand, Italian brand. It's called, I guess I'll mention this again, but Extata, and it's an outdoor design company. It elevates the pleasure of exteriors with products born from this Italian craftsmanship, and every material is processed meticulously with care and compassion and is completely perfect for summer lounging. Next up, we have personalization. So this is really an evergreen idea, but really just not going away. It really continues to appeal to consumers who are increasingly choosing products and services that resonate with them on a very individual level. So as I mentioned before, we know now the consumer is a belief-based buyer and wants to only buy brands and goods that really represent them. As a business strategy, what's really important here is that it can reduce waste, eliminate markdown, and improve overall engagement with the consumer. So brands doing this well. A couple examples here. First, one of my favorite ones in terms of personalization is called Goodwin Smith. It's men's shoes that can be customized with tattoo designs. So we've seen embroidery, we've seen painting, but this whole idea of tattooing leather, especially on footwear, was very interesting to us. They recommend having artwork done by their resident tattoo artist, or you can certainly submit in your own examples. In the middle is Mansour Gavrel, oldie but a goodie, but absolutely love the whole idea of painted monogramming, especially as an exclusive motif that consumers can come and engage with in store. And on the very right, Story Leather, which is a premium handcrafted genuine leather good. And we love this example because it's with car keys. So certainly you can typically personalize like notebooks or all types of like leather goods, but we absolutely love those for our car key fob, especially when I was picking up my car the other day, they were all just like black keys and I couldn't even find them. But if I had this, I would have been able to find it quickly and online. Okay, next up, most importantly, storytelling. What's great is leather is really alive with stories. It's got the story of the earth, of the animal, of the craftsman, of the wearer, and even someone who's inheriting this piece. And each of us who comes in contact with leather adds a new layer of meaning and a new history to it. Some examples that we're really loving in this space is a brand called Italic. It is like calls itself the ultimate DTC brand. It offers better value to the equation. Especially with like the right product at the right price. So what they do is make leather goods that they say come from the same manufacturers as your favorite quote-unquote designer brands, but without the logo and without the markup. And Gemmi is in the middle, another great one in terms of Italian craftsmanship and storytelling, small artisanal workshops, really furthering the craft and aims to share the sense of discovery, of quality, and of passion. And I absolutely love visiting their store. You can touch all the different leather swatches, look at all the different colors, really personalize your shoe, and really kind of have a better understanding of where your footwear comes from. And the last one, Brother Vellies, is another great brand which helps support artisanal jobs all over the world, both in South America and in parts of Africa. They're typically made with kudu leather, which is an animal byproduct resulting from a government mandate culling overpopulation. And it's really supposed to be that forever shoe, so something you kind of keep and wear and appreciate as it ages. Last one, which is obviously a very, very big topic, is sustainability. And obviously this is like a big, wicked challenge to unpack. But what's really interesting to pay attention to is the consumer attitude of ownership has really changed. And what this means is they are now have access to the sharing economy. They're prioritizing spending over experience over product, and they're really paying attention to the circular economy. And that's part of this really regenerative process that we again talked about this morning, but it's really the newest form of sustainability, and circular design is absolutely crucial when designing product and ideating. So a couple examples here that really are across industries. Something I want to mention right now, and I'll talk about this a little bit through here, is you really have to think about both the rental and the whole idea of re-commerce in terms of strategy. Those are the two biggest ways consumers are now actually consuming and engaging with product. There was even a collaboration this past week with Armarium, which is a high-end women's wear styling platform with What Goes Around Comes Around, which is like a resale store that's been around for quite a while. They called it their bought and borrowed pop-up, and they brought together stylists and fashion expertise and highlighted like different popular adaptions of the circular economy and like the new ways to build a modern wardrobe. So I thought that was such a strong example of two brands holding these spaces coming together to create a new type of engagement with the consumer. Additional examples here are Burrow. So if you've heard of all the different mattress companies like Purple or whatnot, they'll deliver a mattress right to your door. This is Burrow, and they'll deliver a beautiful $3,000 mattress right to your door. So it's a sofa in the box. They're all luxurious leather sofas. They have a really beautiful mid-century modern design, and it's really appealing to millennials as they want to try out some investment pieces without necessarily the commitment. Rebag in the center, that's another great example of what we call the re-commerce. They now have online and brick and mortar stores that encourage customers to buy, sell, and repeat. They have a wonderful sustainable cycle of endless luxury, so you can purchase a bag, you can try it out, and if in X amount of months you decide you actually don't want it anymore, you can sell it back to them for a quite significant amount and still you utilize whatever you make to a credit to a new bag, so really keeping that process going. And the last one is Deadwood. It was another great example of both reusing leather and recycling it. They are they rescue dead stock skins and repurpose vintage clothes, upcycle post-production waste. Talked about that a little bit this morning again, but it's for someone who really wants to engage with leather, but also wants to be a little bit more conscientious of their spending and how they engage with leather. So really what they're doing is they chop up old leather garments that reach their expiration in terms of style or wear, and then they utilize it to make beautiful new jackets. So that's mostly it. I just want to re-highlight Fashion Snoops. We do this and more. We work from a macro cultural inspiration to really specific soft goods. We utilize data and AI, which really differentiates us. And we work with lots of different brands in terms of go-to-market strategies and plans for future trend events. If you're interested in talking with us a little bit more, again, my name is Michelle Rotbart. You can also reach our sales team. They're right over here in the corner. Amanda is texting, but I'll give her a shout. That let's bring up our next. Yes. Okay, so if I could please have Liz come up, Massimo and Kerry. They very graciously have joined us for the afternoon. So much for being here with us. I'm going to ask you all one overarching big question, and then I'll have you introduce yourselves and kind of give us a little bit of answer, and then I know some of you have presentations as well. Cool? Okay, so my first big question is, since we talked a lot about leather and consumer wants and values, what is your experience in leather, and how does it serve today's values, and how does it resonate with consumers' desires? Liz, let's start with you. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself and your background?
We're starting with me first.
Yeah, sure.
Well, I'm going out on a limb here, and I'm going to tell you that I'm the only bassoonist who has sat up here on the stage today. Right? Did I win the prize? I think I did. So my background is actually in music, and while all the other cool kids were out doing cool kid things, I was home making bassoon reeds, which you may know if you're nerdy like me, are made from bamboo. Bamboo has a lot to do with how we make leather. So I was soaking my bamboo, I was splitting it, I was drying it, I was carving it, and eventually I made bassoon reeds out of it. So I found myself many years later in the leather world, where I am today, working for Coach, doing something very similar. I'm taking a raw material, which many of you participate in providing to us, so I thank you very much for that. And we're trying to make beautiful things out of it. So I brought an example of a Coach bag. This was on our last runway show. And I don't know if any of your hides went into this bag, but if they did, thank you very much. And I'm very lucky in the position I'm in at Coach today because Coach was founded in 1941. Many of you probably know the brand. And we come from a history of leather. The brand was a leather goods company from the start, and we continue to try to promote and use leather in every way that we can. And we pride ourselves as a team on being very well educated in terms of how we procure that leather, making sure it's from a responsible source, making sure it's beautiful so that we can then translate that value to our customer. So that's a little bit about my background and coach background. Is that a good kickoff?
Yeah. So I'm going to ask you one more question. You mentioned working with coach, and you also talked a lot about when we met sustainability being a key issue for leather. So can you tell us a little bit about leather sustainability strategy at Coach and Tapestry?
Yeah, this is my new favorite subject, actually. And I think it's incredibly meaty and so interesting and also really messy, which also interests me, but that's a side salad. We have very clear goals that we have put out in the industry for 2025. And, you know, Coach is part of Tapestry, so we own Kate Spade and Stuart Weitzman as well. And specifically around leather, we focused on traceability and LWG gold and silver status for our sourcing strategy in leather. Now, those both sound really good, and we're very proud of both of those goals, in addition to a number of other goals which are on our website. You're welcome to go and read more about them. But there's so much more to be done. And one thing that I would like to make sure that all of you guys understand, and hopefully my colleagues here will pipe in on this one as well, is there's so much information out there that I believe the biggest challenge we have as a group, because I think we're all in this together, from leather manufacturers, they want to be called tanners, leather manufacturers to packers to LWG to chemical suppliers from Stahl, is that we all have an ultimate frustration that our customer really isn't understanding the value of leather today. And if they think that becoming vegan means that they shouldn't carry a leather bag, we have to make sure that we're educating our internal customers, our external customers, in an impactful, sexy way so that they get it. And talking about LWG to a Coach customer in a store is not gonna cut it. They don't know what LWG is, right? That's not sexy. So one thing that I would like us to try to work hard on together is to share as much information as we possibly can and educate all of us on where we are today and where we need to go. I just did a total soapbox on you.
It's okay. We like it.
Okay.
Anything else?
I think you answered it very well.
Grab the mic. I've been dropped at the end. Hi, Kerry.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm doing good.
Can you tell us a little bit about yourself and also answer the same question I asked before about how you think, how does leather serve today's values and how does it resonate with the consumer and their desires?
Absolutely. So, Kerry, Brozyna, I've been at Wolverine Worldwide for 7 years. Wolverine houses 12 fantastic brands that I get to work with every day, which is a great opportunity for me. I'm also a 25-year student of the leather industry. I started my career in leather 25 years ago. To say where leather fits the values of the end consumer today, I think what we talked about today in all the presentations prior to this, which were fantastic, by the way, was that, and you actually brought it up just a minute ago, sustainability is a key word. And despite the buying practices of the end consumer, they find it important. But what's even more important is what you're going to find here is from the brand point of view is regardless of the buying habits of the end consumer, we're going to make sustainability a normal part of our business. And once that becomes the norm, obviously that's what people will have to buy. What Frank brought up today a little bit about the population growth, and the really interesting thing is he had that big piece of paper that represented the size of the earth, and then he cut it in a quarter and said this is the size of land. The land mass isn't growing. And if the land mass isn't growing and we're going to go from 6 billion to 10 billion people, where are we going to put waste? The answer is there's not a lot of space. So we've got to figure out an alternative way to make things. We need to make things that last longer, that can be renewed, like we've been talking about today with leather. You put a little polish, a little oil, you bring it back to life, you bring it into a cobbler, you have it resold, and these uppers can last for a very, very long time. Things that last longer means you throw less things away. And that's what we need.
That's awesome. Thank you. And I know you have a coffee to you, okay?
Cool.
Hi, Massimo.
Hi, everyone.
How are you?
I'm good. I think I am the only one here. Yes, at least on the stage.
I like your shoes.
Thank you. So, same question?
Same question, yes. If you could tell us a little bit about your background and then also how you see leather serving today's consumers and values.
So, leathers has been my life since the beginning, coming from a shoe family. That has been everything. Mom and dad didn't want me to be here. They've been doing everything possible to throw me out from this industry. But the smell of the leather takes you back all the time. There is no way. The beauty of this fantastic material. What is leather for our consumer? I believe any leather is on us. We have leathers, and we love the leathers that we are using. There is a commonality between ourselves and what we use every day. We try always to match back with that. I heard about sustainability, I heard about our population, I heard about all this fantastic part of today's concern. I think we need to go back to the origin. We, as a consumer, have been driving this industry and leading this industry, I want to say in the wrong way. Luckily today, the new consumer, the new generation, are driving back this industry and leading the industry in the right way, which is like it was 40 years ago, 50 years ago, probably. That is something that is on us. We can make the change. It is very challenging. But I truly believe that especially the new generation that are sitting into this crowd will help us to go in that direction.
That's great. So I'm going to have two more questions for you, and I believe you have a presentation. Yes? Okay, so when we spoke a little bit earlier, you talked about the evolution of the supply chain.
Yeah.
Can you comment on that?
Well, you know, as Italian, we always believe that everything is best made in Italy.
Yes.
And inside of Italy, we do believe that there are certain regions that they do better certain things, like, you know, the best meat is out of Tuscany, right? Whatever. But I have to be honest, the evolution in general of the supply chain, the globalization of the supply chain, has been pairing with the globalization of the consumer. So as well as the consumer has access to the goods from all over the world, we have been able to access, and more than that, to have being able to use the excellence in different parts of the world. Craftsmanship that we can find today in Asia are absolutely comparable to what we can find in Italy, I want to say. Italy might have expertise on the workers that are more skillful. For sure, that's something. There is an evolution in general, also in some part of Asia, in terms of industry, what industries are sitting in what area. And this is an evolution. This is part also an evolution of the country in terms of welfare. But will be part of the conversation later. The supply chain today is a global supply chain. We'll get leather from Italy, we will get embellishment from China, we'll get the cuoio from Brazil, from Italy. This is the global supply chain. There has been a moment where, you know, each brand can decide which lane to pick, but and that we need to be also very careful with what we call sustainability, about the footprint we leave on the environment in terms of transportation. But my vision is today, especially being able to deliver beautiful products. And we can source those products in different parts of the world.
That's great. Last question. You've talked a lot about excellence. How do you see the designer and luxury brands adapting to this new market?
That's an interesting question. One year ago, there was a conversation internally in my company. By the way, I haven't said who I am. Sorry. Massimo, Bettio. I'm the vice president of footwear for Tory Burch, and I'm honored to be able to work in such an amazing environment as Tory Burch is. So during that time, there was a big conversation about how we can approach the new consumer, millennials, Generation Z, Generation X, and so on. And we had several consultant companies coming in and, you know, explaining the values of the consumer, as you just explained before. Someone made a statement, and please don't get me wrong. Zara and H&M are brand. For me, it was kind of an insult. A brand has an history. A brand has a DNA. A brand has values to sell. It's not a provider or product. I believe that the new generation are more savvy. They know what they want, and they choose the brand that can deliver the message to them with the history and the DNA they have. Of course, in terms of buying, those brands might be expensive. So at first, they go and buy goods from less expensive that look alike. But as soon as they get the opportunity to buy those brands, they're gonna buy from them. That is the challenge for the brands, being able to combine what the consumer wants, the new evolution of the market in terms of what the consumer needs, also from the market, but also going back to the sustainability part, and keeping the DNA of the brand, having the DNA always staying inside of the brand. This is the most important portion. Building a brand, building an history, I want to say nowadays is almost impossible. So who has that has to keep it very tight and use it in order to transform their product according to the needs of the market without losing this DNA.
That's great, thank you. And I'm hearing you have a presentation to share with us. Oh, I have the clicker, yes.
As I said before, Vice President of Tory Burch for footwear, and I want to start with this. And this is me. plenty of pictures inside of the factory, was my playground. I can't remember how many times I fell asleep into the desk of my bed. How many times I had my bicycle with holes because I was running around the production line and there was all those stuff going out because they were taking out all the stuffs from the shoes. And, you know, that was it. That was my life. As I said, growing up, I had to work during summertime in the factory, lasting shoes, cleaning up the shoes. That was, again, life. But mom and dad didn't want me to be there. So they basically support me in anything. And as all the other kids, we have passion. Someone want to be a firefighter, someone want to be a singer, someone want to be an actor or someone. I wanted to be a military pilot. And eventually I made it. I entered the Air Force from someone that is in from Florence, if you know the Scuola di Guerre. I did the Scuola di Guerre, became a pilot in the Air Force military for 3 years. And do you remember the Kuwait War? Yeah, they sent me there. It was not fun. So I decided that despite my love for flying, I wanted to, you know, go back to real life. And the only thing that I knew was about shoes. I didn't know anything else. In the meantime, I was studying at the University of Venice architectural, but I didn't have my degree yet. So I needed a job. Mom and dad didn't want me to get back. So, you left an opportunity, now you need to take care of yourself. So I started working in a very old company. It was at that time just becoming 100 years old. Ski boots and mountaineering shoes, Dolomite. A fantastic company based in Montebelluna. Everything was done in-house, from design, development, production. Had the chance to learn about how to make molds, how to make, there was the beginning of the 3D construction and fast prototyping that today is like amazing. You can do fast prototyping and buying a fast prototyping machine for $90 a day. At that time it was about $900,000. the new evolution. Right after that, when working for Fila Sport, and then one day I received a phone call from an adapter, and they wanted to talk to me about you know, an opening they had into a luxury brand. I was not at all, I mean, you see me today, I was the opposite. That's my friend Alan, I was like him.
Like him. I got you, Alan. Don't worry.
So I went to the interview, and the only name that stayed in my mind was Yves Saint Laurent. So then they called me a couple of days after, and they go, "Are you available for another meeting with the president?" And I go, "Yes." So you need to go to Paris, and you go to the Louis Vuitton Palais. And I go, "I thought it was Yves Saint Laurent." So that was my knowledge about luxury. Zero. Okay. Got hired, they moved me to Paris 1 year, and then after that, started moving around myself in different companies of Louis Vuitton, my time zero. First I was in Berluti, then I went to Celine, then I was back in Louis Vuitton, all in Italy. After that, I was a little bit tired of the French. Don't say that to my CEO. Which was my CEO today, by the way. I went working for Dolce & Gabbana in Florence, taking all the D&G back to the company. Because D&G, the second line at that time, was managed by ETF. It was a beautiful, beautiful experience, being able to source new vendors, being able to hire people, being able to build a new division was fantastic. But I was young. I was just 36 years old. And all the other, as many other of us, I mean, when you have a great career and you grow that fast, you're a little bit full of yourself, which was my mistake. I was full of myself. And I start thinking about, you know, why should I make the other rich? Why I cannot do something for myself, right? I want to be an entrepreneur. I'm coming from that family. I want to be like that. And I, you know, I did my own company. It was a designing company in the beginning, and then after, we start sourcing, making samples, production, blah, blah, blah. Eventually, we end up with a company that, and I say we because there was a team, worth about, in terms of turnover, 15 million euros at that time, which was not bad, okay? But I was just sharing with someone before, that experience made me 30 years older. So a big shout out to all the entrepreneurs inside of this crowd, to all your employer. There is a lot behind that. I have a high respect for Tory. Tory Burch company is just 14 years old and getting from zero to $1.4 billion turnover, it is not easy. And so I have highest respect in front of all the entrepreneurs. So after that, I said to myself, you know what, I want to go back to life. I was at that time, I opened also an office in New York. So I was often in New York and I met the CEO of Berluti, which was I was working with. And all of a sudden, I decided that I wanted to go back. So I went to Marc Jacobs in New York, and then after CBG myself in Los Angeles, and now I'm back in New York. So that's more or less my career. So I want to just share quickly that about how many minutes? Ten minutes?
Yeah, we have 5 to 7 minutes.
So I want to show you, that is what I said in, but this is how many things you can say about my life. This is just randomly. It's a lot. It's a lot. And you keep going, 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 going. And it will finish. So this is what I saw and learned along the way. What I learned along the way is that, and that led me to the different steps, which is, this is it. This is the reality. The reality is us as a consumer. I had in my mind the idea that as a we industry were leading what the consumer wants. Luckily today the consumer are taking the ownership. They decide what they want. We decide what we want. And we are all more knowledgeable. We know what we know. We know about the material constructions, about the right prices, and we are more solid. We also have a better understanding of this beautiful world where we live, which it's just one. We don't have multiple choices. This is it. We can just take this one. And it is like our life. It's up to us how we treat ourselves. And it is the same about where we live today. So if we are able today in capturing today this transformation, you know, I was having a conversation with a friend about this moment, and I made an analogy. He said, you're wrong. My analogy today is that this time to me is like the Industrial Revolution that happened in the past. Someone is saying, no, the digital revolution has been bigger. I think today we do not understand we are making a revolution. We are making a revolution. And the revolution is led by us, not by the industry. We, us as a consumer, are leading this revolution. And the revolution will be about human sentiment. I've been listening before about how can we help emerging countries about corporate responsibilities and so on. We have to do it. We have to help everyone. We have to help everyone in order to create a sustainable life. Life, sustainability is translated in just two words, it is the footprint that we leave into the world. Less we leave, better we can live in this world. I truly believe that the new generation that are sitting here have the possibilities to lead us as humanity in a better world. But I have just one answer. Please, be patient. I know you have been studying a lot. I know you have been investing a lot of your time. But that's not it. It's not finished. You still have a long way. And you can learn from the, can I say about myself, dinosaurs, okay? You can learn. I'm still amazed sitting beside my father and having him sole in his shoes. It's beautiful. It's beautiful going into a tannery and seeing how they treat the leather. It's amazing seeing all these processes.
Thank you. Very
exciting.
So to gain market share in the footwear category, we have to realize that in today's world and with today's consumer, leather is beautiful, but it's a material. And it competes where, you know, the full grain used to compete with the split, and the split competed with pigskin, and et cetera, and there was no sheep. Today, it's one vast opportunity of materials for all of the new designers. So what we need to do on the leather side to regain that market share is we need to differentiate. We need to understand that the brands are looking for great stories, and we need to pass on the great story of leather to the brands so that they can pass that on to their end consumer. We need to follow the diamond of success in terms of we need to make sure that our product is right. We need to make sure that our customer service is right. And one of the biggest things today is delivery in full on time. The end consumer today is very impatient. We talked a little bit today about just-in-time manufacturing. And I've argued for many years that the end result of just-in-time manufacturing means that not everybody's just-in-time. It means a lot of people have to be early. They have to be ready, right, beforehand. So those are some of the key things to regaining market share, just in summary, differentiation, explaining where we come from, where we go, why we're better than many of the alternatives that can be chosen today.
That's great, thank you.
All right. So first of all, I have to apologize because when Frank showed that chart, I was in that age category where we ate more than the recommended amount of proteins. And as of last night, I think we need to reset that upper limit because we definitely blew it out of the water. So apologies there. So imagine if we had a beautiful product manufactured sustainably by partner suppliers committed to continuous improvement and innovation. Imagine then that the raw material used to make this product is durable, renewable, versatile, and plentiful. You might notice that I stole a couple of those adjectives from earlier presentations. Finally, imagine this product created was desired by the end consumer globally. If all of these things meet in the universe, then we've got something, right? And we are there. So today I'm going to talk to you a little bit about a brand take on what's important from the consumer view. I'm going to share with you just a little bit of the data that we look into in a couple of the surveys that we've taken that kind of focus in on that bullseye that is the consumer and the consumer need. Before I do that, could I just ask a show of hands, number of people that are involved in this room from the packer side or hide selling side or hide production side? Okay, so put up your fingers, number one, and keep those up. The forefinger, please, not the middle one. Okay, so number two, how many people are here from the tanning and chemical industries? You're gonna do two fingers. Okay, number three, designers and brands, including young designers. Okay, so this is one of those events that connects these three parts or multiple parts of making footwear. And it's a tremendous experience that we have here because typically, if you go a couple steps back in the supply chain, they don't get the opportunity to talk to the end consumer or to the designer. The designer doesn't necessarily talk to the people who produce hides. Things that happen in the hide market are 12 months before the design cycle is over. So what that means is if prices go up or down, the hide guys might not see any change in their business. Specifically, if they go up, like they did in 2013, they don't see the result of that for 12 months. So things keep chugging along, and all of a sudden, that ripple hits the shore, and boom, the leather business drops, right? And what happens after that is that then it takes another 12 months to get back, because then the prices drop, and then they get back into that cycle. So meetings like this join all of those stakeholders together and give us a real opportunity. So I'm gonna move rather quickly through this, but what I'd like to do is give you a little picture of some of the things that we do as a brand and what we look at. First of all, knowing who our consumer is and knowing what they want. This is a generational report done by Cassandra, and I'm gonna focus on the highlighted Gen Y in the interest of time. Not to say that the roughly 133 million people and baby boomers and Gen Xers aren't important, but what we have to understand is that both in the Gen X and baby boomer population, if you look down to that very important spending power line, those spending power numbers are going to start to decline. And as Americans, as we enter retirement, we typically spend 30% less than where we were gainfully. So we're going to look at that 75 million that's Gen Y and what's important to them. I'm going to use another survey to talk about the four things that we've been told are important to that millennium consumer. The first one is comparable for all of the generations, and that is high quality product, right? Who doesn't want a high quality product? And what it means in this instance is that high quality means that it's a value for what you're paying for in the final product, that it lasts long because, as we mentioned, people want things to last longer so that they throw away less, and that it's something that they can keep nice. It can't just last a long time, but they want it to look nicely. The second thing is a little bit different. This is where we start to move away in the millennial generation, is they want a product that supports their individuality. So in the baby boomers and Gen Xers, I won't volunteer for which one I am, the idea was we buy from great brands that we can trust and have great product. In the millennial generation, they like brands, but they also like their individuality. These people ask their friends for input on the product that they buy, but they're not necessarily gonna wear the same things that their friends wear. The next one is responsible manufacturing. They want their products made responsibly, and I'll get into that in the next slide. And then the final thing is they want brands that represent who they are. And this is why you find great brands today, great running brands like Saucony, that spend time at all of the races, big and small, where their consumers are running. They want to know firsthand how the consumers are feeling in their footwear. That's why great brands like Sperry and Merrell and Chaco spend time on the ocean front or the riverfront or the mountains where their consumers are, so they can identify firsthand what the opportunities are and what the challenges are for their consumers that need to be solved. And the next step, we're going to talk a little bit about that word sustainability. And in 1997, which is a few years ago, a gentleman wrote a book about the triple bottom line in business. And the triple bottom line is what I call a three-legged stool. The reason I do that is I've had a lot of negative experiences on a three-legged stool. When one leg breaks or it's not so sturdy, what happens? The stool falls, right? So the triple bottom line is really the model that I think best gives us an example of where sustainability can live. Sorry about that. So it takes consideration people, profit, and planet, right? And then in between where those circles merge, that's where we can have sustainability. We're all interdependent. And if we ignore one of them, the other two will suffer and that stool will fall. So I wanted to keep this short because I was told 10 minutes and I also want to have time for questions, but we have all the tools available to us to find the answers for this new millennial generation, which is going to have a tremendous power and a tremendous spend. And in reality, this is the generation that is going to be our increase or decrease in market share for leather products. So extremely important to finish this up that we make sure, as I said in the beginning, that we differentiate. We make people understand why leather is better, why it's important that they use a sustainable material. And number two is brands, as I said to Liz earlier, is that the end consumer isn't necessarily ready to open their pocket and spend more on a sustainable product versus a less sustainable option. But if we as brands take the lead, and you as suppliers take the lead with us, then we can change the dynamics of business and where this model will move forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'm going to finish up this round with a lightning speed round because I think what you guys all spoke on really resonates. So Liz, I'm going to pass the mic to you and ask one more wrap-up question, which we'll kind of ask everyone. So since we talked a lot about the future consumer, where do you see the industry moving in the next 5 to 10 years? And if you had a magic wand, how would you adjust to what's happening in the industry right now?
Okay. I definitely see a lot of anxiety in our industry right now, whether it's even within our own building. There's a lot of fear around global warming and sustainability. We don't have plastic straws anymore. People are very nervous. I don't know if you guys are nervous, but a lot of kids are nervous that I work with. And so I believe there will be a tipping point, and I think we're coming to it fairly quickly. Yesterday at LWG, we talked a little bit about some of the brands that are making a lot of noise on Business of Fashion and WWD, like Caring Group. You guys probably read that Stella McCartney is joining LVMH. That should be interesting. So there's a lot going on in the fashion world that is going to affect all of us. And I kind of liken it to food consumption. I know years ago, we used to eat Spam and go to McDonald's for egg McMuffins and things like that. Many of us now spend more money on food, our own food, because we realize that organic is better. Maybe grass-fed might be better. And we're willing to trade up for it. And there was a tipping point with food. And especially here in New York City, I don't know how many of you are from here, we spend a shit ton of money on food, okay? And I see that coming with fashion too. I don't believe that it's going to be cost neutral to do what we need to do, but I believe in our consumer, and I think a lot of what these gentlemen were talking about too resonates with all of us, that we can kind of capitalize on this fear, in not a bad way, but in a good way, to drive change and to help our consumer be as educated as we all need to be. And again, I go back to my point where we really need you guys to help us to have the knowledge to share on our sexy platforms out to all of our consumers so that we can make that change. But I definitely think that it's not going away, and brands like ours, probably agree, are either, we're in a sink or swim situation now, basically. What was the purpose of it? I forgot now.
Well, you kind of answered it, but if you had a magic wand, how would you love to adjust what's happening in the industry today?
If I had a magic wand in this moment in time, I would create a shared platform for information. Because every single person that I've talked to one-on-one over the last 48 hours who is in this industry has told me their passion project. Well, did you hear about this brand? They're doing that. I literally took the subway with my next door neighbor this morning, who was a journalist for Wall Street Journal. And she's like, but did you hear about this foot brand, footwear brand? This is what they're doing, and they're da-da-da-da-da. There's so much information out there, and there's no one place for it to live. Even large organizations, like we were at LWG yesterday, or here we are in another large organization, or you know, we're all going to be in Linea Pelle in Milan shortly, and we'll have another conversation there. But we're having too many siloed conversations. There are too many small things happening that are all coming from the best place. Everyone wants to do the right thing, but they're not going to be impactful enough to change as much as we need to change unless we start working together. I had a very nice conversation with my colleague at Michael Kors yesterday, who, as you know, is my arch nemesis. But we and I said, you know, let's go have dinner, let's go have drinks, let's talk about it, let's figure it out. Let's, you and me, sit in a room and just pound it out. Like, what do we know? Who did you talk to? We're all calling the same person at Burberry. Like, why are we doing that? We should be sitting in a room having a brand conversation and including all the information that you highly intelligent people have out here. So if I had a magic wand, I would make that happen.
I like that. It's all about the sharing economy. Interesting question. Lightning round. Hot seat.
Magic wand. What Liz brought up is really important. And in our industry, I think we look at too many things as intellectual property. And in reality, within the brands or within the suppliers, there's two different things that we can work with. Number one is intellectual property, which we leave where it is. And the second is best practice. And if we work together to initiate and install best practice throughout the supply chain, throughout the design process, That's where we're going to make a big change in how things are done.
Thank you. Last question, lightning round hot seat, magic wand.
The magic wand for me would be leaving more to the product creator. We really don't leave this product, we just want to sell it. The amount of development we do it is incredible. We have 70% drop rate, just to give you an idea. I think my colleagues have the same issues. We need to leave more our products and love it more. That's my magical one. I think sharing, we are doing, I want to just prize the Linea Pelle organization for today's meeting, because what we are doing here is sharing information. And I agree with Kerry. Today we are putting together the three main components of this industry. We are missing the fourth one, unfortunately, which is the consumer, but we are all consumers. Okay. So there are all the four components sitting into this room. And so I think in terms of more information, sharing information, you know, I want to just go back to carrying intellectual property, very important for everyone. But we have an Italian sentence, il segreto di Pulcinella, okay, doesn't exist. It's just a secret, a poor secret that we hide, but it is nothing. So we need to be able, really, there is nothing to hide. All the information should be available to everyone.
Thanks so much. up afterwards. We're very excited. Thanks, guys.